What did the abuse at Owairaka Boys' Home do to you as a boy, a man, a future father and husband?
After experiencing that, I became a non-conformist, hated everybody, hated the cops especially, hated authority. And it was getting to the point where I was starting to hate myself, you know.
Tatala e pulonga, lifting the dark cloud of abuse and cruelty these Pasifika survivors faced as children. For Fa'amoana Lua Futu, his early years in New Zealand were marred by cultural and language barriers. All too soon, Fa'amoana became a truant, leading to his placement in Owairaka Boys' Home at 13 years old.
It was like run like army, physical training. Every morning we're 10 bare feet laps around the football field, you know, summer or cold, it didn't matter. Scrubbing a yard with a toothbrush. Some of the masters will make us fight on Thursday nights, call it boxing nights, and we'll just beat each other up, you know. And the sexual innuendos that they give out, you know, as you're in the showers, you know, things like that. Don't really want to get into that, but those are the kind of things I've seen.
Activist, musician and expert witness Tingi Lau Ness remembered the traumatising ways in which neighbourhood children were taken into care.
They were there 1 minute and we were kids and we were all playing in the streets and the next minute they're gone. And I often wondered what happened, you know, what happened. Later on I find out about idle and disorderly and being put into welfare as a start, taken away from parents who didn't understand what their children were being taken to. Our young ones were locked up solitary in prison cells where adults only meant to be. In solitary confinement for days, weeks, and sometimes months, because they had no support, nobody knew where they were, and they were treated like mentally ill patients.
Tingi Lau also spoke at great length about the dawn raids of the 1970s, and for Tesi Moni Fuavau, this is where his ordeal with state care began. As a sickly 20-year-old, Tesi Moni's family had secured a medical visa for his treatment in New Zealand. An exchange between Tesi Moni and a police officer at a local pool club led to a dawn raid at the family home a few weeks later, where police barged into the room his parents and his younger brother Masiu slept in.
Ko time ko nei fa mai ko polisi ko ke hen kap ko ek mam ek fa e na ne fusi ia tu me ia masiu na tang I forgot me a masiu time ko ia mo piki pe me o hen kap na pa ko na pa ko me ta pa pa pi hat ke polisi I heli do english time ko ia na I lo na pi hat why you do that for pa ko ne fo itali pe ma mana tu I
Tesi Moni's parents spent nearly 2 days unlawfully detained in Mount Eden prison, unable to contact their sons or speak to a translator. At the Pacific hearing, Tesi Moni's niece spoke of the impact this had on her grandparents.
There were some things that my grandparents did that we didn't understand growing up. We were always told to lock the doors every single day. We would never miss a day. And throughout the whole night, it was us grandchildren. We had to go and constantly check if the door's locked, if the windows are locked. We had a sleeping roster with my grandparents because my grandmother, she couldn't sleep alone. She always had to have somebody sleep in the room next to her or with her in the same room. We realized that this is the trauma that my grandparents were still living through.
With the lack of mental health services targeted at Pacific communities, many of the survivors have lived with their trauma for decades, taking their hurt and pain to the grave. Expert witness Leota Dr. Lisi Pitaya believes the lack of cultural care offered to Pacific people through the mental health system is a form of abuse.
The system that we're in is very monocultural, but New Zealand is a country of many cultures and diverse cultures. So it's important for those people to actually understand how Pacific people think, especially with something like mental health, because it's a very stigmatized thing. So it requires a lot of education and knowledge to empower people to understand what the issues are and to know where to go to for help when they do start to have mental distress or mental health problems. So if we deliver the clinical services using that cultural knowledge, it's very effective.
For Fa'amoana, it was the arts that saved him. He's become a prolific writer and actor, using the theatre to tell his story.
God works in mysterious ways, and I think the reason why I'm here today is because he had that purpose for me, you know, that I'm going to be here today to be the voice of those that aren't here no more, you know.
What they did was wrong. They have to admit that it's wrong and that they'll do their best, like with our help, of course, never to allow it to happen to any child.